Hello, this is Shenzhen I. If you don't know what it is, a link to the game is in the video description. But I would like to talk about this PGA33X6 chip, because it has been a bit of a mystery. So here's the manual for it. Yeah, not much to see here. And even if translated, there is not much useful information. But anyway, let's talk about it, break it down, start from the basics. So it has three inputs on the left and three outputs on the right. We can try this out with some switches. By default, nothing is happening, but you can see already that this input can switch these rows. The top one or the bottom one is active. Same for this and this. We don't look at this yet. This is a special input, but yeah, we will look at it later. So to actually work with this, you need to put some dots, fill in some dots around here. So we are saying, with this dot, we are saying to activate this column when this line is active. Or we can do the opposite, activate this column when this line is not active. So yeah, you cannot fill in both inputs, so let's do something with this. This column is active, which means we can put some dots around here to activate this row when this column is active. And this goes directly to the output. So we can see the line goes like that, and to the output. So we can activate the top output with the top input. That's fine. We can do the same with each line, like this. Put this when this is active, and this when this is active. So when this column is active, we can activate the second row, and this the third row. So now you made the most useless chip ever. But yeah, it is what it is. Then we can see the next thing. So each column is actually an AND gate. It's not as simple as I made it seem. So we can say activate this line only when both of these conditions are true. So only when both of these are active. Or we can do the opposite, like activate this only when this is active and this is not active. So yeah, this is an AND gate. And the same happens here. So we can say when this is active and this is not active, what we had previously, and when this is active and this is not active, we can activate the first line. So yeah, this is active and this is not active, so it's active. This is active and this is not active, so this works. That's fine. So yeah, and we can hook up the third input independently, whatever. So basically this input activates this, and this goes here and here. It works independently, and the previous thing that we programmed still works. So this is like this bit array, like an array of conditionals. It works like that, simply. And what I would like to point out next is, even though this is an analog input, it clamps all the inputs to 0 or 100, so you can't work with actual analog inputs, just true or false. So yeah. The next feature I'd like to talk about is that not all of the lines simply go to the output and that's it. We have this S here and R here. So this is like an RS latch or whatever it's called, and when you activate the S line, the data is set, and when you activate the R line, the data is reset. So you can hook these up to some inputs. Let's work with buttons now. So I hook it up like this, and when I press the button, this goes to the S line and the data is set. When I press this, the data is reset. and no matter what you press, the data will be still there. So this is like changing buttons to a switch, a latch. So now we come to this thing. Previously we had each of these rows directly correspond to the output, but when you're working with this data, you may want to hook it up to the upper output instead. And now this line doesn't have an actual output because this line is broken. So yeah, now we have this. Activate the output because data, like I said, goes directly here, and we can clear it. Quite simple. Now we come to this thing. It's getting a bit complicated, but these rows of inputs are hooked up to the data. So whenever the data is active, this line will be on. So we can activate a column, do whatever. We can activate the third when the data is on. So as you might guess, these lines will actually be equivalent because this one is connected to data directly and this one is connected to data through this contraption. So yeah, you have choice. You can keep it like the top line, you can directly connect this and do whatever you want. And that's the basics. So it seems like there is a lot of potential for this chip. You can take different combinations of Boolean inputs and turn them into different combinations of outputs. You could even say, like, when the data is active and this line is also active, do something. But I haven't been able to find any use for this whatsoever in normal puzzles. You can also see that, well, this power in sandbox mode, it does nothing, but in actual puzzles, whenever any state here changes, it eats 3 power. So it's a huge power usage and it's completely useless when you want to optimize your solution for power. And it's also a bit bad for cost, because it costs 5 yuan. There is, however, one area where this chip seems to be particularly useful, and it's for solutions which you want to use as few lines of code as possible. So one of the important features is that whenever this S line is set, it takes one cycle for the data to change to a 1. And the same, if this line is set, it takes one cycle for this data to change to 0. It is important because this seems to be the only chip which has this feature. And let's compare it to our array of NOT gates. No matter how many of them I put, all the changes propagate through them instantly. Here we have a controller that cycles between a 0 and 100. Let's see what happens. As soon as it puts 100, all the changes propagate through here instantly. Now let's see what happens if we put this through our chip in a particular configuration. So the configuration is like this. What we have is, as soon as this is enabled, we reset the data. And as soon as the input is disabled, we set the data. But as you remember, the data setting is delayed, and we want to output the data, of course. So you will see that this will be delayed. Let's see now. So as soon as the 100, everything here changes, everything. And only the next tick, we see the change here. And now, just straight to the usage. I will reveal to you how to make a rising edge detector. So we connect this to this and this. We have two inputs, and first I want to take the input from it, the output. So as soon as this 100 is set, we have the AND gate enabled, but only for one cycle, because on the very next cycle we will have the data change, because of course this column is already active, the reset line is already active, but the data is still one, and on the next cycle this will be gone. So this is a rising edge detector. Now we'll hook it up to the button instead, so you can see what I mean. And yeah, even though I press the button, the blink is so small that the game doesn't even show it. So let's connect it to a controller instead. We will have the input here. And we will just add this input to our accumulator and sleep one. What do we have? As soon as I press the button, the accumulator increases, and no matter how long I hold it for, it doesn't increase anymore. So yeah, you probably remember the scorekeeper puzzle for the drinking game or whatever. You have this exact same thing there. Someone presses a button and it should increase the point by one. Well, we don't want the accumulator to grow by 100 immediately, so let's change this like this. We can use this chip to convert from 100, whoops, to convert from 100 to a 1. The first digit is set and this is converted to a 1. So instead we add x0. And then we just hook it up to a display, whatever. Alright, we connect the display and we move this to the display accumulator. And what do we have here? So in that puzzle you also had another button that sets that it is supposed to decrease the score by one, and you might think that you should be able to copy this thing exactly the same, connect it to the same controller and just instead subtract from another input. But the problem is that the rising edge detector works only on the very first cycle of a time unit, and this will not work. This, like, I can even demonstrate it by adding a nope here, no operation, and this will just break, because when this input is on we waste this input by using this. So yeah, I don't know how to finalize it to a solution that would basically solve this scorekeeper puzzle in 4 lines of code. But I know that some people have figured out to do it this way, some workaround to have basically this code, but hook up the two rising edge detector in some different way to get a full solution in a great record with few lines of code. So I think that's it.